Tēnā koutou katoa. Good evening, everybody. It's a great pleasure and privilege to be here this evening, and thank you for turning up, and thank you for braving the sort of lovely summery conditions that we've got today here in Wellington. At this moment in time, so 10 past 6 on our 1st of February, which is sometime on the 31st of January in the United States, Donald Trump's presidency is 11 days, 12 hours, and about 6 minutes old. And by my calculation, that's still less than 1% of a normal 4-year term. Now, that should alert us to the hazards of making straight line projections on the basis of what we've already seen since the 20th of January. We've got to be very careful not to extrapolate too much. We need to remember that the Trump administration remains incomplete. There's quite a few cabinet nominees who are still awaiting Senate confirmation. And we simply can't now know the full range of challenges and opportunities that the wider world will present between now and 2020 to Mr. Trump and his colleagues. Quite what happens to America and to us in the remaining 99% of Mr. Trump's first term of office remains unclear. So that, I'm a bit hesitant here, and that might strike you as a bit strange, because we already know that some of the more controversial campaign moments and utterances of Mr. Trump are becoming more than utterances. There's executive orders and presidential memoranda that are now spilling out, that are now part of an expanded array of options for Mr. Trump as the holder of the world's most powerful elected office. He's not just been tweeting stuff, he's been doing stuff. And of course, with one of those very early strokes of his pen, the new president canceled America's involvement in the Trans-Pacific Partnership. So years of challenging regional negotiations suddenly ended on the cutting room floor of American domestic politics. Mr. Trump has also set in motion the process for the repeal of Obamacare. That's no accidental choice, because it was Obamacare in a way that was the signature piece of domestic policy innovation that his predecessor put forward and got through. Mr. Trump's anti-Mexican rhetoric on the campaign trail has been followed by the breakdown of one of America's most important bilateral relationships. A political war was already in place well before a physical one gets built. And fears that climate change mitigation would disappear as an American priority seem to be fulfilled by signs of its disappearance from the White House website. Climate change has become a non-person, a fact too uncomfortable to be acknowledged. And I hardly need to remind you about the most controversial step of all. That's the executive order which has the title Protection of the Nation from Foreign Terrorists into the United States. The New York Times editorial board calls these restrictions on entry to the United States bigoted, cowardly, self-defeating policy. The Washington Post's equivalent has branded this as a train wreck of decision-making. In erecting a travel fortress against citizens from 7 Middle Eastern countries and Syrian refugees, the Trump team have achieved something quite remarkable. The new administration's first international crisis is one all of its own making. It's a drama playing out in the domestic politics of several of America's partners. It's not been an easy time for leaders who have given the appearance of wanting to soften their criticism of the new administration in the hope of building a strong relationship with those who now govern the world's most powerful country. So not a great start for Mr. Trump on the world stage, you would say, and you'd be right. But what we haven't seen yet is something that will undoubtedly come at some stage. A crisis driven not by the elevation of anti-Muslim populism into an executive order, but a crisis which results from external provocation, misunderstanding, or disaster. Something that some other country does, and the US is left to respond. All administrations go through these. Just think of George W. Bush's first term and the impact that the 9/11 attacks had both on his presidency and on American foreign policy. Or think of how the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan and the Iranian hostage crisis really spilled the end for Jimmy Carter. Or think of the escalating problems in Crimea and Syria and the challenges these pose for the Obama administration's foreign policy in the second term of Mr. Obama's presidency. Now, we're only 1% along the way, as I say, still early days. But at some point, Mr. Trump and his team are going to be tested by some external behaviour. It could be a provocation from North Korea. It could be a significant terrorist attack in Europe. And despite the warm fuzzies between Mr. Trump and Mr. Putin, it could be a Russian response to NATO's increased deployments in what used to be called Eastern Europe. It could be a test from Beijing designed to challenge Mr. Trump's flirtations with a two-China policy, or to challenge Secretary of State Tillerson's robust language on preventing China's access to features in the South China Sea. I'm hoping for what I call a good-bad crisis. A crisis bad enough to require America's attention and its action, but which somehow demands that the Trump team reach out to allies and partners and potential adversaries for their cooperation. A crisis that reminds the new administration that there is a reason why we have the United Nations and international agreements and norms. A crisis where Mr. Trump realizes the importance of the daily briefings the intelligence community really wants him to get, and where he sees the value that America's diplomats bring to the table. And a crisis where he decides that the kitchen cabinet of Bannon, Kushner, Flynn, Conway, and Priebus needs to give way to a real one. So there's still room to hope that things can improve. I think we have to have a bit of optimism here. But rather than speculate on what might happen, whether that's for better or otherwise, we're actually required at this stage to make an early assessment of the Trump foreign policy. What does it look like now? And to New Zealand eyes, at least, I think what we see so far is not very pretty. The first observation I'd make is just how elevated domestic political issues are in Mr. Trump's vision of the rest of the world. That is, to me, the real sense of America first. I tell my students that foreign policy begins at home. Those of us who study and teach international relations and strategic studies often overlook the importance of domestic factors. A lot of textbooks and articles still do that. But I think under Mr. Trump, the domestic factor in American foreign policy is being magnified. We are, of course, used to seeing America view the world through an American lens. That's not unusual. That shouldn't surprise us. But here, I wonder if there's almost no view of the world happening. The world is not so much being seen, but obscured through a lens of a form of American populism which Trump has mobilized and been mobilized by. That's one explanation for Steve Bannon's elevation onto the National Security Council and the demotion of officials whose counsel the president really does need. The second observation I have is that America first is pretty much America only. Its interests are not global ones. They are American interests which are primarily for American consumption, speaking to his base. There's a telling portion in Mr. Trump's inaugural address, which many of us will remember that the moment we were sat there watching, probably sometimes with mouths open, which reads as follows. We will seek friendship and goodwill with the nations of the world, so far so good. But we do so with the understanding that it is the right of all nations to put their own interests first. We do not seek to impose our way of life on anyone, but rather to let it shine as an example for everyone to follow. Now, that's not just a repudiation, I think, of American intervention to promote democracy, in line with Trump's criticisms of US policy in the Middle East and his challengeable claim that he did not endorse the 2003 war in Iraq. Instead, everyone in Trump's universe looks after themselves first. It's a me-first approach. And at times, there's only one me. There is, by definition, no such thing as a global perspective or a global interest. And global values don't really exist either. A third observation follows from these points. If the world is full of actors putting their own interests first, that really is what international relations consists of. Now, in the past, we've had rather sterile debates, at least in the academia, they may not have penetrated more widely at times, between two views of international cooperation. Some scholars are more optimistic and believe that countries will cooperate even when they realise others may be gaining more out of that cooperation. Because if everybody is benefiting, that's enough. And to some extent, this view underpins a lot of trade negotiation, climate change negotiation, arms control negotiation, peace treaties, and so on. People don't benefit equally from cooperation a lot of the time, but if they're all benefiting, or most are benefiting, it's enough. But then, of course, some believe that countries become nervous when they realise others are gaining more from the cooperation than they are. All countries in the situation, or this perspective, are locked in competition even when they're cooperating. They're nervously looking at who's gaining an advantage out of working together. This makes cooperation fleeting, and it makes defection from bargains more likely. All agreements become fragile, and it is almost as if institutions don't really exist. I think Trump appears to bring an extreme and almost perverse form of the second argument in his view of the world. He's expressed doubts, for example, about how much America will commit to NATO if smaller members are not seen to pay their way. And as well as scrapping the TPP, NAFTA is suspect because America's partners, in Mr. Trump's view, have been ripping off the American worker, an argument that played well to his base in the campaign. And Mr. Trump's view on the United Nations would make George W. Bush seem like the Secretary General's best friend. So he's pretty dismissive of that form of international organisation. Now, what seems really especially absent in Mr. Trump's worldview is a recognition of the broader benefits that international cooperation has meant for America's position in the world. Some might argue that what we have come to call the liberal international order is simply a veneer for American international primacy. But if that is what it takes to convince a Trump administration of the virtues of global governance, then I say so be it. It was to America's advantage to see the post-war emergence of economic and financial institutions such as the GATT and the IMF and the World Bank. That did not make these multilateral endeavours disadvantageous to others. Indeed, smaller powers such as New Zealand stood to gain even more. But that we did benefit did not somehow turn the United States into a loser. But that's almost the philosophical extension of Mr. Trump's logic. I don't even know if he's a zero-sum thinker. I think he's almost a negative-sum thinker. And likewise, the American alliance system in post-war Europe and in Asia called on disproportionate contributions from Washington. In the course I'm running on allies and adversaries, we talk about this. The concern that Washington's often had that, you know, that there are countries that free ride a bit. But that was not because Washington was duped into signing bad deals which only benefited the free riders. As the leading provider of global public goods, Washington was furnishing for itself an unparalleled leadership position. But that's not in the Trump view of history. The last several decades of America's international primacy actually paint a different picture, I think, to the view that he's promoting. You just can't sustain the number one position in the world simply by having the world's biggest and most energetic economy with all the jobs that were supposedly stolen by other countries returning to America. Nor can you have that position by throwing even more funding into your armed forces, even if these are indisputably the world's most advanced already, and even if you're willing to countenance a new round of nuclear arms racing. That's not enough. American primacy is not a number. It's not been like the size of the crowd at the inauguration. It's apparently the biggest we've ever seen. Or the size of the president's election win, which apparently was a landslide. Or the size of other things, apparently. It's about that leadership of these institutions. Now, an essential ingredient to this leadership is the ability to lead international cooperation. That's sort of the point I'm making. And that takes us back to the TPP. Now, views on whether the TPP would benefit New Zealand where it really matters remain mixed in the debate here, partly because people are using different indexes of what really counts. In America, it became so much of a hot potato for Hillary Clinton that she had to pretend that she didn't like it anymore. So she was it created a bit of a U-turn for her. Now, I haven't read even a significant portion, a small portion of the TPP's enormous contents. But I do know this. Along with other smaller and medium negotiating partners, New Zealand believes that it cannot get where it wants to go without trade and investment cooperation. This includes bilateral free trade agreements, including the ones we have with Australia and China. And it also includes plurilateral arrangements, which is what the TPP would have become. Moreover, New Zealand and other countries view great power involvement in these arrangements as a sign of their willingness to offer a form of leadership. America may not have started the TPP, let alone the P4 that preceded it, But America's leadership was important once Mr. Obama saw it as part of his approach to Asia. Now, you can reverse that story. If a great power knows that smaller economies put a premium on trade and investment cooperation, their involvement in these deals, the involvement of the great powers in these deals, provides them with the prospect for regional influence. It's then the job of New Zealand and others to find ways to ensure that the influence of these great powers in these things is conducted responsibly. Now, I've long bemoaned the tendency of New Zealand politicians, especially in recent times, to treat foreign policy as a variety of trade policy. Mm. We've been too commercially focused. Yeah, yeah. But that said, if there was one thing that Washington could have done to cement its regional credentials in Wellington's eyes, it was to endorse the TPP. And that moment has now passed. And from it, at least two things I think follow. First, it would be easier if Mr. Trump's opposition to multi-country free trade agreements such as TP was simply because of populist judgments which play to his base about bringing jobs back. But there's a broader point as well. One extension of the size matters philosophy, which Mr. Trump has very much adhered to, is that he wants instead a series of bilateral deals. And in those bilateral deals, the big guys are favored, and it's almost as if the smaller economies need not apply. And I think you've seen Mr. English downplay the chances of New Zealand grabbing Washington's attention on this sort of thing. And part of the criticism, I think, from the Trump view of the world is that these wider and more inclusive groupings allow smaller countries too much influence, pushing larger powers like America into concessions they don't really need to offer. And if the Trump administration proceeds on that basis and actually ends up conducting a review of America's participation in multilateralism more generally, which has been some of the suggestions, then we'd all better watch out, because that would be a direct challenge to New Zealand's interests. New Zealand has invested a great deal of its diplomatic capital over many, many decades into the international institutions that allow us to have a voice, but which also we think reduce the chances that international relations will be a law of the jungle dominated by great power competition. And it will actually increase great power cooperation because of their involvement in it. I think that was part of the approach we took to our time on the Security Council. And America has been there at the creation, ironically, of so many of these parts of the liberal international order. If Washington was to instead become a chief adversary of those order-building institutions, a fundamental crisis for New Zealand's foreign policy would have developed. Now, I believe that some of Trump's inner circle would have no problem if their desire to challenge the Washington establishment, and apparently that's what Mr. Bannon is there for, led them to tear down the fabric of international order, which they probably view as kind of globalist indulgences. And I also believe that Mr. Trump would have little concern if the global economy suffered in overall terms, as long as he could say to his voters that America was winning. That's the international side of America first, negative sum game. Now, the question is, who's coming to the rescue here? And as you might have seen, and I've been writing a little bit about this, one of those possibilities is perhaps China. What better competition to this negative sum gain logic than to argue that globalization has actually been a positive feature of international affairs, something that New Zealand would agree with? And isn't there therefore an opportunity for one of America's international competitors to steal the march in the knowledge that the world will be now looking for a new great power champion of free trade? And that appears to be the conclusion that Xi Jinping has drawn. Even before Mr. Trump gave his allegiance to the US Constitution, before the hugest crowd the world has ever seen, the Chinese leader was making just that pitch at Davos. That's clever politics, I reckon. And you might say, well, you know, that new emperor doesn't have that many clothes. We keep hearing stories, of course, about the fragility of China's economic picture. But as the members of the Trump campaign team know, there is always an alternative reality to paint out. And in fact, it's not an alternative fact. China remains an essential trading partner for so many of us in the Asia Pacific. And to be honest, there's not a lot of competition for that champion of free trade position. Now, if Beijing plays its cards right and limits its own tendency to allow its own domestic political factors and concerns and the nervousness that the Communist Party often feels to drive an even more assertive foreign policy, it may achieve a status that was somewhat mysteriously suggested by Bob Zillick a few years ago, which China, I think, struggled to understand what he meant. And that was the notion that China could be seen as a responsible stakeholder. And that would be a pretty good mantle for China to achieve against the backdrop of a volatile and damaging Trump presidency. But to do so would require more than an endorsement of globalization at a time when that word globalization is poison to the Bannons and Farages and Lepans of this world. It would require China to show real restraint should Mr. Trump decide that tariffs and other escalatory economic measures need to be enacted and not just talked about. At that point, it will be China's call on whether a bilateral trade war ensues, with very significant impacts for the rest of us in the Asia Pacific. Now, on the security side, being a responsible stakeholder in the region would demand special restraint from Beijing should the Trump administration start playing the Taiwan card or turn its freedom of navigation operations into an attempted quarantine around parts of the South China Sea. For domestic political reasons as much as anything else, that would be a very challenging moment for Mr. Xi and the Communist Party of China. If that restraint came, however, I'd expect it would mean many more countries in Asia would countenance bandwagoning with China, especially if America's commitment to the region was proving a mix of neglect and overreaction. China's sphere of influence, which is already there in parts, could well expand. But actually, like the rest of the region, New Zealand would be looking for other forms of reassurance. I can't help think that we'll be spending a good deal of our time, not just thinking about what America is doing or not doing, and how China may be taking advantage of the volatility that American action or inaction creates. I expect we will want to be caucusing with other key partners in the region. That means Australia and Singapore, it means Canada, it means thinking about Japan and how Japan and Korea see things, it means thinking about new and emerging security partnerships as well. How will Vietnam and Indonesia and India respond, for example? It means investing time in our relationships in Europe. And I think Europe's going to bear the brunt of a fair bit of the Trump animosity. That, after all, is where so many of the globalists come from. And some of them will even survive in Britain after Brexit. And ballast is going to be needed here, and I expect new coalitions to form which will place new demands on New Zealand's bilateral diplomacy. And we can only expect that if Washington expects less from itself and even more from allies and partners in that kind of transactional view of alliances, where those allies and partners have apparently been shirking their role, then the logic is that we're going to be expected, or we will be doing more in our part of the world, including, of course, with Australia, including in the South Pacific. What we can't afford to do is spend all of our time being mesmerized by Donald Trump. That's exactly what the last several months have been like for American politics, and in a way for international considerations as well. The stream of tweets, pronouncements, insults, and executive orders do seem calculated to keep everyone back on their feet, you know, sort of off their toes, unable to resist or to deal with the shock of the last salvo, to sort of unable to kind of deal with what's going on because the next one has already arrived. Whether that can be sustained is an interesting question, but I'm sure Mr. Trump and his team will try. What we can't afford to do is to let our view of the United States be dominated by the new president. That's not as easy as it sounds. His approach is not so much America first as Trump first. It's a very personalized approach to things. But Mr. Trump's low popularity numbers suggest that he does not speak for as many Americans as he thinks he does, or as he says he does. The protests which have erupted over the travel restrictions, the dissent position that is currently circulating around the State Department, and signs of friction even within the Republican Party all suggest an important point. And that point is this. To treat Donald Trump as the embodiment of enduring American values would be a travesty. To see him as the logical extension of an America which sometimes goes overboard in its desire to leave the world would also be a mistake. We all of us know Americans who do not share his view of America or of the world. We know that there are many American officials who see value in international cooperation. We know that they were there when the Obama administration decided that the first part of the rebalance was for America to participate more fully in East Asian multilateral cooperation by way of the East Asia Summit. We know an America that, like all great powers, is capable of error. And like all other countries, including New Zealand, is capable of hypocrisy. But to view America through the lens of Donald Trump's view of America and his view of the world is to let alternative facts become our own vantage point. At the same time, however, and we need to acknowledge this, he is the new commander-in-chief. He's the leader of the world's most powerful and influential country. He chooses if and when America launches nuclear weapons. I'll pause there. So it is not as if other countries, including New Zealand, can pretend that he's not president. That would not be an alternative fact. That would be a dangerous alternative reality. But there will still be many opportunities for New Zealand officials to work with like-minded officials in Washington.
Yeah.
In some parts of the US system, including the intelligence and diplomatic worlds, they'll need our support and understanding. And it would be an error to assume that a Trump administration will always overreact, even though I think there is every likelihood it will do so on more than one important occasion. Moments of pragmatism will emerge, and there are little signs of that already. Even if the new president does not want to talk about democracy as a global value, for example. And even if his relationship with someone as inspiring as Angela Merkel is as frosty as Mr. Obama's was with someone as questionable as Mr. Putin. What about New Zealand-US relations? What sort of final points? I think one of the biggest challenges for our diplomats is to ensure that New Zealand's interest in an effective relationship with the United States is maintained under three conditions. One is the inexperience of so much of the Trump team on foreign policy. A second is the radical departures from American foreign policy consensus that some of Mr. Trump's immediate advisors will be suggesting. And how the long-standing officials will try to have to make some way of connecting what they do to that. A third is the temptation of arguments in the wider international debate that it is somehow possible to bypass Washington as an important partner. To kind of just, you know, leave it to its own problems. I think Bob Hawke is right to argue that right now is not the time to isolate America, even if it seems that this is what Mr. Trump is doing to his country. We know that a Trump administration will not be talking about the pivot or the rebalance to Asia. That's Obama-Clinton speak, and that'll be redacted from the website if it hasn't been already. I'm sure it's gone. Some of the factors which have encouraged Washington to seek a closer partnership with New Zealand may change. But if Trump solves the situation in Afghanistan and Iraq, for example, everybody will be surprised. A miracle will have been wrought. And I think in that and other cases, the United States will continue to have to work in partnership. We shouldn't expect everything will change. The momentum that has built up in the New Zealand-US defence relationship will not suddenly come to a screaming halt. And the demise of the TPP will not kill off the US-New Zealand trading relationship that has been built up over the many decades without it. Long-standing friends have every right to disagree and to do that publicly. Some of the Trump positions are and will be an affront to our values and our interests. There may be particular moments of concern and moral hazard. That could come if Mr. Trump feels emboldened to rewrite the American rules of the game on the use of force, on respect for the civil liberties of minority groups, on the freedom of expression, on the treatment of captured insurgents, and so on. But we need to believe that there will be chances for America to turn things around. I think we need to recall that while 11 and a half days has already been a long time in politics, the next 4 years will pass. None of this is going to be easy. Some of our assumptions about the way the United States will want to lead need to change, partly because it is not clear how much a Trump administration will want to lead internationally. New Zealand will not be able to assume that for the next 4 years, America's commitment to international institutions will be nearly as significant as it has for much of the post-war period. That is changing. We have even more reason now, if we were not doing so already, to question the confidence some have that Asia's many decades of great power peace will survive. We do not know quite how China will adjust its calculations of American resolve and what that will mean for the pressures our region will face. But will we still have an economic, military, intelligence, and diplomatic partner of the United States in 4 years' time? I think so. There will be moments where New Zealand will need to distance itself from the Trump administration, and it will need to be willing to do this in public as well as in private. That's not least because New Zealanders need to know that their government is aware of the values and interests it is charged to protect. But that distancing is not just about criticism. If someone else is busy tearing down the fabric of international society, calling them out for it does not negate the damage or create something in its place. We need to be working with others to ensure that the damage Mr. Trump does is minimised. And along with the rest of the world, we need to keep effective relations going with our United States connections to ensure that the damage can be repaired. So thanks very much for listening to me. I look forward to your questions.